Good morning, C2 Church.
Good morning.
I'm Pastor Jeremy. It's great to be back with you again as we continue our series called Breakthrough about marriage and money, or relationships and money. Today we're focusing on marriage. I'm super excited about that. Thank you, Pastor Matt, Pastor Darcy, for bringing to us awareness of Fort Columbia. If you haven't gotten signed up, go ahead and do that now. I'll let you do that. Be on your cell phone while I'm talking, but do it quick. Awesome. And get yourself an awesome t-shirt. They're like the best t-shirts in the world. They have the best t-shirts. So if anything, just do it for the t-shirt, right? Isn't that? No. Poor motivation. So last week we talked about breakthrough. Breakthrough happens when intentionality and perseverance meet divine assistance, right? If you're looking for a breakthrough in your life, specifically maybe in a relationship, that there has to be an intentionality, there has to be a perseverance, and then God is faithful. That his divine assistance is that moment of breakthrough. If you look through all of Scripture, you will see that breakthrough happens when the intentionality of the person and the perseverance through hard circumstances is coupled with God's divine assistance. Last week, we encouraged you to pursue holiness, to pursue wholeness, and to pursue wisdom. How many of you did that this week? Raise your hand. Four of you. Awesome. All right. Pursue holiness, and then pursue wholeness, and pursue wisdom. And so this morning, as we dive into marriage, why marriage? Why is that such a big deal? Well, it's the first human relationship in all of Scripture, right? There's a priority of marriage within Scripture from the beginning of creation, and our world needs healthy families, strong families, and the only way that we have strong, healthy families is through strong, healthy marriages. So if you're not married this morning, when you're sitting in this room or you're watching online, don't tune out and say, well, this isn't for me. I believe that God's word can inspire you and be illuminated to you in other areas of your life, in other relationships, to bring healthy habits to those as well. And so you might glean some of that as well. Maybe you're not married, but you're hoping to be one day. Then this message is for you. Lean into it. Take notes. Well, you should always take notes, but take extra notes. And if your marriage is in trouble, let me just encourage you. If you just feel like your marriage isn't in a good place, that my wife loves this phrase, and I'm just going to steal it from her. From this day forward, maybe the Lord will do something this morning, speak to your heart, that will inspire you to take another step. Maybe to lay down your pride this morning, to step into a new habit, a new way of speaking, communicating. I don't know what it is, but just know that the Lord is here this morning. And instead of looking backwards, look forward in faith that God is doing something this morning, first in your heart and then in the heart of your spouse. And that's important. So don't nudge your spouse this morning. Hey, this is for you. Listen up, right? This is for you to capture, and then for your spouse. I do believe we need a higher regard for marriage. It almost seems that marriage has lost all value in our culture. Since we've moved that any two people can get married by the government, that we've lost its intentionality, that there was a purpose for marriage in the beginning, right? I've done many weddings in my day. And there's one phrase that I can say, maybe I should say, but I have chosen to leave it out at times. Because at the end of the wedding, I say something, by the power vested in me, and some people will say, by the state of, in our case, Missouri, I now pronounce you husband and wife. But years ago, I stopped saying that because it's not the government that grants me the power, or even the couple the power to get married. It's God himself who gave the institution of marriage by his divine mercy and providence, created marriage. And so it's by God's divine power and authority granted to me as the minister overseeing these nuptials, these vows, this covenant that's being made, right? It's not a contract. The world views marriages as contracts. We'll talk a little bit about that later. But the biblical marriage is a covenant, one with another and with God included. We need a higher regard for marriage. We need to think of it more than as a part of the journey of life that I just get married and that's the thing that's going to make me happy. I'm telling you, if you're not happy before you get married, if you're relying on some other person to make you happy, first of all, that's unfair to them, right? Have you tried living with you? Right? If you pursue any relationship, specifically marriage, simply to meet your need or to make you happy or to meet some need in your life, you're using the other person. You're using them. What if God's purpose for marriage was greater than my selfish desires and my personal happiness? I like what Gary Thomas writes in his book, Sacred Marriage. If happiness is our primary goal, we'll get a divorce as soon as happiness seems to wane. If receiving love is our primary goal, we'll dump our spouse as soon as they seem to be less attentive. But if we marry for the glory of God, to model his love and commitment to our children and to reveal his witness to the world, divorce makes no sense. Thomas goes on in his book to ask this question, not about how to find a happier marriage, but he asks this question, though. He says, how can we use the challenges, the joys, the struggles, and celebrations of marriage to draw closer to God? What if God designed marriage to make us both happy and holy? Do you need a breakthrough in your marriage this morning? Don't answer out loud. Do you need to move from brokenness to wholeness, from confusion and frustration to purposeful and fulfilling, from self-centered to self-giving, from surviving, from just surviving to thriving? Then this word from the Lord is for you. Write this down if you're taking notes. Breakthrough marriages aren't accidental. They are intentional. Breakthrough marriages are intentional. They're not accidental. You don't stumble into a good marriage. I think I was under the impression that when I married Darcy, my parents had a good marriage. Her parents had a good marriage. They both are still married to each other today. By osmosis and by hereditary, I was just going to have a good marriage, right? And I just relied on that, on my own intuition, my own wisdom, my own thoughts. I'm pretty good at stuff, you know? I generally can get through life without screwing things up too much, generally. And I tell you, we struggled the first year, first 2 years. And I think we've talked about year 10, like, I at that point was like, I'm not figuring this out. I mean, we had a good marriage, but I wouldn't say that we were thriving in all areas. You know, of course, we were parents and we were trying to navigate that as well. But I found that the more intentional I became about growing personally in marriage and learning the skills and things that it took to be a good husband, that there was greater growth. And I can recall these moments of going, oh, there's a breakthrough moment here. Oh, there's a breakthrough moment. Because God was doing something in me. And God was opening my eyes to my own imperfections, as few as they are, right? Breakthrough marriages are intentional. They're God-centered. They're God-centered, but then they're others-centered in their attitude. And there's an unwavering commitment. And that's how you have a thriving marriage. We're going to talk a little bit about that this morning. I want to get into some just fundamentals of marriage from a biblical perspective. Marriage is a divine institution. And I use that sort of in the generic phrase, not as an institution like a human institution, but a divine institution given by the divine mercy and providence of God. In the creation story, in Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, then the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him. Go on to verse 20, the last half of that verse. But for Adam, there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, This at last is bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. This account in Genesis chapter 2 is after the creation account, right? In Genesis 1, we have the 6 days of creation. On the sixth day, man is created, and it's said is very good. And when you get into chapter 2, it's kind of confusing if you're not aware of how the literature is written. It's sort of this like flashback and expounding upon that sixth day of creation when man was made, right? So we have a little bit closer view of that sixth day of creation when man was made. And so we see here in verse 18, the Lord God says, it is not good that the man should be alone, which is in stark contrast to what God says in verse 31 of chapter 1, when he looks at everything he's made and he says, it is very good. So what happened? Well, when we flash back to that sixth day in the creation of Adam, the Lord looks at Adam and goes, boy, if a guy is all by himself, it's nothing but trouble. It's not good that he is left alone. God in his wisdom saw that everything was good except that man was alone. And in order for God to find him a fitting helper, at first the Bible says that all of the animals of creation are brought to Adam. And from there, God and Adam go, yeah, there's not something quite right here. None of these fit me quite right. There's something wrong. Well, it's very obvious to God that none of animal creation has the divine spark of glory in them like Adam does. There just isn't the fit. Was the job overwhelming for Adam? You have to ask yourself, like, why wasn't it good? Couldn't he do it by himself? He could have. It would have taken him 3 times as long. It would have been done wrong, yeah. And then, but was the job too big and overwhelming for Adam? It seems to indicate that Adam needed companionship with someone comparable. That's sort of the idea in the Hebrew phrasing there. Someone comparable to him. Not just like him, not a clone, but someone similar to him. And the animals obviously didn't fit that in any regard. You also have to understand that God doesn't seem to fit that either. Did you ever realize that? Was God not enough? There was something that God knew in his wisdom that Adam needed, that God himself couldn't provide. God was not human. He was so other than Adam, and Adam needed that relationship, but he needed something else. And so therefore, by God's divine mercy and wisdom, he gives him Eve. God gives him a helper, or in some of your translations, it says a helpmate that's fit for him or matching him. Those are sort of like these terms that we're trying to glean from the Hebrew. And I find it so fitting that God designs an other-centered relationship in a somewhat me-centered world. Adam by himself would be me-centered, but he puts someone in his life, and both of them must then become other-centered. So we're gonna get into the controversial word of helper or helpmate. Should we dive into it? Should we just get messy this morning? Right? So it's interesting that the word that is used for helper there, when God couldn't find someone suitable for him, he said, I'm going to make him a helper fit for him, or a helpmate, right? And the Hebrew word there is the word ezer, E-Z-E-R, or ezer. This word means more than helper. It's this idea of someone who supplies strength in an area that is lacking. in the one being helped. The term that it does not imply that the helper is either stronger nor weaker than the one being helped. The idea of Ezer actually implies an ally or a rescuer, right? This is the Hebrew word that we're speaking of. It's someone who comes running when the people cry out for help, when the person cries out for help. The Ezer drops everything that you're doing to help those in need. Ezer is a hero. That's what that word means. How do we come to that conclusion? Well, that word or forms of that word are used 21 times in the Old Testament. Two of those times are here in the creation story, talking about the woman Eve in Eden. 15 other times, do you know who that word is used to describe? The Lord God himself. The Lord God himself is the Ezer of Israel. He's a rescuer. He's a defender. Are you getting a different picture than maybe what our world has described as a woman? There are even Christian institutions who teach other things. We'll just say that. And in our own mind, maybe we've learned other things about what our spouse, our wife, should be. But what a thought. Being an Ezer had nothing to do with being subservient or a docile assistant or a submissive sidekick, right? We would never describe God that way, would we? No, we would never think of God in those roles. But the wife is called to play a unique role that only an Ezer can play. One of my favorite scriptures from the Psalms says, some look to chariots and some look to horses, but where does my help, my Ezer, come from? My Ezer, my help, comes from the Lord. Right? This is such a divine position to be played, right? That every woman, every wife should take the role of Ezer very seriously as you share that description with Yahweh himself. Now, that does not mean that you're the sole inheritors of that designation, right? Since every human is made in the image of God, every person is an Ezer in some way. And if you look at yourself in marriage as an Ezer to the other person, you have a divine role, a divine anointing. You've been placed in a special role to help your spouse, to be their ally. As God was often the rescuer and he was the ally of Israel herself. Breakthrough marriages come through intentionality, not through accident. Let me give you three things this morning that I hope will help you as you view marriage. Maybe you're engaged, maybe you're working towards maybe being married someday. I hope you'll write these down. Breakthrough marriages. First thing, breakthrough marriages understand and pursue their mutual purpose. Breakthrough marriages understand and pursue their mutual purpose. In Genesis 1, 27 and 28, I don't know if I put 27 in there, but I'm going to read it anyway. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Verse 28, and God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over everything. God created marriage for a purpose. God created marriage for a purpose. Through marriage, he would sanctify the whole world. He would bring his glory throughout the whole earth. There's this idea in some theological circles that the Garden of Eden was a very specific and enclosed area, and that the rest of the world had yet to be tamed, that it was wild and still chaotic, and that man's job, when I say man, I mean humans in general, was to take the glory of God throughout the rest of creation, subduing the chaos and bringing order to it. And so he gives man and woman their purpose: be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over everything. So God gives a loyal partnership, a loyal companion to humans. One man, one woman. And they would be his representatives to all of creation, right? And they would mirror the relationship that God had with people. They would mirror that through their own relationship. And so he says, fill the earth, govern it, right? The idea of glorifying God by bringing his name and his being his image bearer to every space and every place they went in all of creation. So how would the first humans learn to govern? Who would teach them? Who would show them? God himself. They would learn from God himself. They would learn to govern and care for all of creation, right? This is the idea of having dominion over all of creation. Usually when people hear the word dominion, they think of dominance. I've got to be the master. I've got to whip things into shape, right? And that's not the idea here. The idea of having dominion is having a unique role and authority over, right? So in your unique role and authority over all creation, Adam and Eve, you have to care for it, bearing in mind that you are the image bearer of God himself. And how you treat creation will reflect on God and his name, right? There's a responsibility when there is given dominion, when there's given authority, there's a responsibility. And so Adam and Eve must be deliberate in how they were to manage and govern and steward and care for all of creation, right? Because they were God's representatives to a wild and chaotic world. They were to multiply. That's right. They were to have babies. Lots and lots of babies. See, when God said multiply, he knew that the family was the ideal, perfect setting for children to flourish. It was the firmest foundation that could be created for children to thrive. This was God's ideal plan. One man, one woman, together, united, new life would spring forth and the world would continue on in the glory of God. That's obviously not how it is today. The ideal seems to have faded, but church, can we hold on to that ideal? That family and marriage was God's ideal plan for human flourishing. And if I were to say something to married couples or those who see marriage in their future someday, that you have a vision and you understand God's purpose for your marriage. We recently did a marriage retreat here at C2, and it was about having a vision for your marriage. And the feedback, right, honey, like the feedback on this retreat was greater than any retreat we've ever done, because people began to grasp a vision for the marriage that they hadn't had before. That they suddenly felt like they had an aim and they had a purpose. And they weren't stumbling about. And we heard so many people say, thank you for doing this, for allowing us to help, for helping us. Because suddenly they were grasping something that they didn't have before. Married couples, you need a vision for your marriage. What is it that God has called you to do in general, right? I just gave you some examples of the purpose of marriage, but what is it for you specifically? How are you using what God has called each of you to do? How are you bringing that together? How are you bringing your unique values and skills and temperaments? How are you bringing that together to glorify God, to raise your children, to be a witness to the world about God's love, right? This is what it means to have a vision for your marriage, that we just don't go into it and go, well, we'll figure it out. Yeah, you will figure it out. But what if you had a vision from God? You said, God, give me a vision for my marriage. Give me a vision of how I'm to treat and elevate my spouse. Lord, give me a vision. I encourage you today, take time to explore, discover, and then decide what is God's purpose for our marriage, and then how are we going to pursue that together, right? Because ultimately, God has a mutual purpose for your marriage, right? You're not two people going in two opposite directions that happen to share the same address. God has a mutual purpose for you to discover and then to move upon. Breakthrough marriages understand and pursue their mutual purpose. Second, breakthrough marriages make their spouse the priority after God. Breakthrough marriages make their spouse the priority after God. Everybody say, after God. After All right, I want to make sure we understand that. Matthew chapter 19, Jesus is responding to a question about divorce, but he brings it back to the purpose of marriage when he answers. He says, "Have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female and said, therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife," right? He's quoting from the Torah of Genesis, and the two shall become one flesh. He's asking them a question. And then he makes a statement, "So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate." Right? So Jesus is revisiting the purpose for marriage, and he's expounding it to what God has put together. Don't let any man or person or human separate, right? God's desire was not for divorce. And we understand in our world, divorce happens for one reason or another. And there's no condemnation today in that. We just understand there are circumstances that have happened. So for those who are married, what do we take from this? What does this mean? What is Jesus saying to us by quoting from Genesis? Here's some non-negotiables. Number one, leave and cleave. Everybody say leave and cleave. Right? It's the idea when the scripture says, leave his father and mother and hold fast. That word hold fast is cleave. So leave and cleave, right? That at some point you leave your mom and dad, you leave the house of your childhood, and there's this idea of growing up, got to grow up, don't look at your spouse, and then you hold fast to your spouse. You don't let go, you squeeze them, right? You are bound to them, you are leaving behind your childhood, the relationship with father and mother, to who at that point were your authority. They gave you direction, right? And now you're on your own, but now you are clinging to your spouse. They are now the priority. And you're creating together a life that at this point does not exist. And Jesus reiterates this idea of one flesh. Male and female, they become one. They might be two, but they are now one. This idea of almost like reunifying into a whole, right? Eve came from Adam, and now God is bringing through marriage, bringing them back together. It's a profound mystery, Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 5. And so being one flesh, yes, it involves the act of sex. I said the S word. It includes that. But it's so much more than that. It's not less than that, but it's so much more than that. Because it means that you've left your parents' household, you've established a new family, you're building a life that does not exist yet. And your priority, the primary human loyalty that you have now, is to one another alone before anyone else. It's a permanent bond. It's a mystery. Whenever we counsel couples, we talk about building a life that doesn't exist. You don't bring your singleness into marriage. That's a surefire way to blow up your marriage, is to keep thinking like a single person. Well, I'm gonna do all the same things. I'm gonna hang out with my guys as much as I want. You can. You certainly can. You won't have a good marriage, right? You realize in marriage, you can do anything you want. I've told guys this. They're like, "So I can't do anything I want anymore?" No, you absolutely can. You're just going to suck as a husband. I mean, you just got to choose. If you want single life, you want that life, then don't get married. Don't get married with the expectation that she's just going to be one of your buddies, right? That's probably my biggest pet peeve, is watching guys treat their spouse like one of the guys. Yeah, just one of the guys. You talk to her like one of the guys. Oh, she's not one of your buddies. She's not your pal. She was a gift from God. Speak to her like that. The two become one. It's a profound mystery how God can take two individuals who are selfish at their core and stick them together, and something that's good can flourish from it. not just having a child, but a marriage. Something can come of it. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians makes this statement. In chapter 7, he says this idea. He says, hey, husbands, you should satisfy your wife's needs. And wives, you should satisfy your husband's needs. And he goes on to say, a wife's body does not belong to her alone. Amen. Thanks, Brian. Nor a husband's belong to him alone. And some use to justify this to get something from their spouse, specifically in the area of sex. Well, you know, the Bible says, oh, we're going to go there. Okay. There's more to it. A husband should satisfy his wife's needs. There might be a specificity of sexual desire and needs there, but it is greater than that. What other needs does your spouse have? Every guy in the room's like, well, she has one need, and I know what that is. No, gentlemen, if you want that, you better figure out what her other needs are first. Right? There is the profound mystery, figuring that out. And if we are to take from the image bearer of God what we need to satisfy our desires, we've screwed up. What Paul is saying to us is about giving, not taking. When you enter into marriage, you are now an other-centered person. Your goal, your privilege is to serve your spouse and meet their needs. And I always encourage people because they begin to think, well, what if they don't? What if I give everything and they don't give anything? Don't worry about it. I have found that when I give everything, that my wife is like, well, I want to be part of that too. That's how a healthy marriage works. We're concerned about the needs of the other. And in that way, every need is met. Every need is met. You give, not take. They don't owe you. You owe them. We like to talk in marriage sometimes about marriage being a 50-50 proposal, right? Because when it comes to divorce, right, you just split everything down the middle. And so we use that as a basis to build our marriage. Well, this is mine, and that's mine, and this is my half, and that's her half, and we all get equal share. Well, if you do that, all you have is division. But what if you looked at your marriage as an opportunity to give 100%? And if you both give 100%, guess what? You have a hole. You have a hole. And none of us are perfect. We all need to grow. But our goal should be constantly to give 100%, meeting every need of our spouse. And we don't use that as a way to get what we want. Well, you know, honey, I mowed the lawn the other day. Right? As if she owes me something. You are now one. Think of your spouse as part of your body. You must care for them. Don't neglect or abuse or mistreat or starve them. You see, your own body is supposed to function in harmony with every other part of your body, and so too with your spouse. If you neglect them, if you fail to meet their needs, what happens if your organs aren't getting the proper nutrients or hydration? They start to malfunction. It turns into dysfunction, disability, disease, and ultimately death. Jesus says what God has joined together, it implies that marriage is not merely a human agreement, that somehow we just made this contract that if it ends, we can dissolve everything and each take our share. But that's not what biblical marriage is. It's a covenant. It says, I will become this for you. No matter what you choose, I will do these things. I like to think of it as a God-centered triangle. Do you have that picture? Maybe you've seen this. There it is. where husband and wife are on either side of the base of the triangle. And as we grow closer to God, we actually grow closer to one another. Maybe you've seen it. It's a very simple depiction of it, but I think it's very true and very effective. That the closer you grow to God, the closer you're going to grow to your spouse, the stronger you become. Your wife or your husband is your priority after God. So pursue God. God does the joining. Did you capture that? What God has brought together, right? So give him that ability to bring you together by growing closer to him. And God can't be the priority of your marriage if he's not the priority of your life. Before kids, oh, I know, that's an idol in this world. Our kids become everything, right? Suddenly you're traveling every weekend, you're missing church, right? Be careful that your kids don't become your idol and your spouse the annoyance. Kids are supposed to be the annoyance. No. Sorry, that's not how that was. If you don't put your spouse first, you're doomed and your kids won't grow in a healthy manner. They won't know what a healthy marriage looks like. So your spouse needs to be first before your job, before money, before your hobbies, right? And he says, don't let anybody separate this marriage. That means friends, anybody outside of the marriage, right? Anyone you allow to interfere, right? Young couples sometimes struggle with parents or siblings interfering in their marriage. You've got to guard against that. What about other friends or BFFs? All other relationships, it doesn't matter. They're secondary. But what about your own thoughts? Sometimes our own thoughts separate us from our spouse, right? Your own attitudes, actions, neglect, they can start to cause that separation. So you need to prioritize their happiness. Well, what if that means I'm unhappy? Trust me, if you prioritize your spouse's happiness, you won't be unhappy. One, you'll discover the divine joy of serving, right? That's biblical, right? They'll discover a love that then they will want to reciprocate, right? I'm telling you, it's a pattern. If you begin to serve and love your spouse in ways that you haven't before, it will come back to you. But you got to stick to it. You got to persevere. Had a guy once tell me, well, I started taking out the garbage. I did it like 3 times and she didn't say nothing. Really? That's your basis for treating her like crap, was because she didn't recognize this minute change that you made for like 3 seconds? Stick to it. Persevere. Prioritize their happiness. Prioritize their holiness. Prioritize their wholeness. Prioritize them with your, listen, with your eyes. Gentlemen, where are your eyes drawn to? If it's drawn to anything that's not your spouse, you need to fix that. Don't be the guy in the grocery store whose gaze is always for some other woman. Let your eyes only be for her. Prioritize her with your ears. Confession, I have to work on this one. I know she's talking. I just don't listen sometimes. I have to turn things off, set things down, look her in the face. I'm not looking at her right now because she knows I'm right. Prioritize your spouse with your touch, with your thoughts, and with your time. How do I know if they're my priority? Ask them. Ask them how they feel. And then receive it without defensiveness. Yeah, but if they say, well, I feel like you prioritize your job. We don't have time together. Yeah, well, you want to eat, don't you? I actually think some wives would rather starve physically and be shown attention by their husband. They'd rather be poor than not have that close intimacy with him. I know for guys, if you ask them, how do I know if they're my priority? Well, they should just know. My wife should just know she's my priority. How should she just know? What does that mean? Just no. Well, I work extra hours and I buy her stuff. That doesn't count. What if that's not what they actually want? What if working long hours and doing your thing is just an excuse because you don't know what to do or you aren't willing to give up what you want? And women, please don't say, well, he should just know. I can guarantee we don't. Right? We're not mind readers. We can't even read our own mind, let alone yours. Remember, 100%, 100%. I need my two volunteers. Where are my two volunteers? Michael and Stephen, come on up. You've seen the tape up here this morning. You're like, what is the tape? So we're going to get in. The last one we're going to get into is breakthrough marriages have a healthy approach to problems. And I wanted to illustrate the idea of giving 100% and 100%, which goes not only to the point of priority, but also that we know how to handle problems together. So what I'm going to have them do is if you guys would stand in your spots down here. And what I'm going to have them do is I'm going to have them get to the end of this line or as far as they can by leaning into each other. Stephen, maybe take a half step back there. There you go. Perfect. And they're going to lean into each other, and we're going to see how far they can get. But they, right, this is to illustrate togetherness. So I'm just going to let them go. We talked a little bit about how to do this before. I haven't really given them any tips. I just told them what I wanted. So, all right, here we go. They're trying to get as far as they can by leaning into each other. Here we go. Look at that. Keep going. Uh-oh. Keep going. Come on. One more. One more. One more. One more. Oh, yeah. Okay. Good job. Okay, so we did a little rehearsal, and they pretty much nailed it. Now, you're both strong. I was gonna say fairly strong, but you're both really strong. So you had that going for you. Now, here's what I want you to do. As you do this, I want you to both, instead of looking at each other, I want you to just look down and keep your elbows bent and see how far you can get. Keep your elbows bent. Okay? Go. Okay. It doesn't work so much, right? Okay. Now, here's what I want you to do. Stephen, I want you to lean towards Michael, but Michael, I don't want you to lean as much. I want you to try to stay as upright as you can. Go. Keep going. How far can you get? Oh, my gosh. Michael's struggling. You're hurt. Okay. That was harder, wasn't it?
Oh, man, he weighs a little bit.
I'm so sorry. Yeah, that's right. But that was harder.
Oh, much harder.
You guys seemed, the first time you did it, you were both leaning in, and what I noticed, you were both looking at each other.
Right?
You weren't looking
and
down. And you're communicating, right? Ready, step, right? Give them a hand. Thank you, guys. Yeah. Hey. Actually, Michael and Stephen, if you want to stay up here for the band, I'm going to invite you to come. That wasn't intentional, but it worked out. See, there's an idea there that I want you to capture, that as spouses, when you're leaning into one another, each of you being the other's ezer, helper. See, I actually learned this on a high ropes course. And when you're up 50 feet in the air and you got a harness and a belay on you. The only way to get across to the next station is with another person because it's a single cable with enough slack in it, you really couldn't make it by yourself. And so you had to lean into the other person. I happen to have across from me an all-star lineman that was on the football team as part of our youth group. And he probably easily weighed 250 to 300 pounds. And I didn't. But we made it across because we leaned into each other. And if instead of looking down at the ground, the problem, the danger, we looked at each other We talked to each other. We communicated. We moved together. Kept our arms locked, trusting that the other person was doing the same thing. And what we discovered as we did this was students who didn't trust the other person, if they kind of kept their elbows bent, they didn't quite lean into the other person, they would fall. They'd have to start again. And some it took several times. Some didn't even complete it because they couldn't get themselves to lean into the other person and trust them. And they never felt the joy of success of completing that obstacle. Have you figured out how to respond in your marriage to disagreements, annoyances, problems, arguments, fights? Ecclesiastes 4 says this: two are better than one because they have a good reward for their toil. For if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and has not another to lift him up. Again, if two lie together, they keep warm, but how can one keep warm alone? Though a man might prevail against one who is alone, two will withstand him. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Where did a threefold cord come out of two people? It's because God is part of the equation. When you walk together in harmony, doing your best to be the other's Ezer, even when you face the challenges and problems, you're coming out the other side, displaying God's love and grace through the whole process of figuring out the problem, the issue, the challenge. How can you use those challenges to glorify God? I think when couples face challenges in life, one, we first go to God, right? If I can give you some tips, go to God first. There are things that you're going to face in your marriages that you need God's wisdom. You can't do it on your own. You're not smart enough. And you're selfish. Everybody say, I'm selfish. Now, if your spouse is here today, look them in the eyes and say these words: Darcy, I'm selfish. Don't say Darcy, say their name. Right, we're selfish human beings. And only by God's grace and the power of the Holy Spirit can we overcome that. We're prideful. I'm not going to say I'm sorry, right? And I did something the other day to Darcy in just an interaction. I was short. I don't think I'd eaten. I think I was coming down off my caffeine high for the day. I have lots of excuses if you ask. And I said, I'm sorry. I think I misunderstood. I didn't come. That's not how I want to be. That's not who I want to be. Right? And you know what? My wife is so full of grace. And when she demonstrates grace and forgiveness, it's like a catalyst for my spirit. Well, that wasn't so hard. Spouses, when your spouse apologizes or is attempting to apologize, sometimes our attempts aren't real great. Encourage it. Join in. I'm sorry too. It seems like you're having a tough day. It seems like you had a moment there. It's okay. Oh, okay, thank you. But if you get aggressive and defensive and you start tearing me down, you know what I'm going to do? Okay, let's go. Let's do this, all right? We're going to tear one another down, right? Go to God. Let his Holy Spirit fill you, right? I go to God first. I don't call up my mom or my dad or my BFF. Like, you won't believe what my mom did. You don't need someone to jump on the bandwagon. You need to go to God. Next tip, always start with the thought, we are in this together. We're together in this. Lean into your Azer. They're not just like you, so they're not gonna think like you. They're not gonna react like you. So talk, communicate, believe the best in them. We're in this together. Fight for each other. Gary Thomas, in that same book, Sacred Marriage, he says, lean into their strengths. Focus on those strengths, not their weaknesses. If you know their weaknesses, then compensate for that. Now, if you know your weaknesses, you should work on addressing those, right? It's not an excuse, right? Encourage rather than criticize. You know, when you speak words of life and encouragement, something comes out of that that's good. If you criticize, something comes out that's bad, right? What kind of seeds are you sowing? Are you sowing seeds of encouragement in life rather than criticism and negativity? Pray for your spouse instead of gossiping to somebody else, your coworker, whoever might listen. Pray for them instead. And then personally learn and live what Christ teaches about relating to others and love and grace. Are you personally growing in that? Are you personally growing in grace and love? Not just demanding it or expecting it from your spouse, but are you personally embodying that and trying at every moment to display that to them? When my wife acts in grace and forgiveness, like I said, it's a catalyst to me to walk in grace and forgiveness myself. And now I walk in courage to be the person I really want to be. I learn what it looks like to receive forgiveness from Christ when she demonstrates it to me and I demonstrate it to her. Next tip, we keep the problem, right? Oftentimes in disagreements and conflict, and this is in all relationships, instead of making the problem, we make the person the problem. So how can you, in a moment of conflict, say, what's the problem? Define it. This is the problem. We don't talk about anything outside of that. Unless it's directly related to the problem, we don't talk about it. How can we keep the problem, so that we focus on fixing and moving through rather than hurting one another? This is the time when, if you don't define the problem, this is where we start to threaten, blame, attack, accuse, ignore. We start using the D word, divorce. Christian marriages should never resort to using the D word. Once you begin speaking that word out, it's a big danger. We take responsibility individually, right? That's another tip. Take responsibility individually. What part do you need to own? What things are going on in you that you need to own and move through? Again, no blame, no excuse. Granting grace to one another, right? Get help. That's the next tip. Breakthrough marriages, they get help. If you're not thriving in your marriage, it's okay to say, I don't know, I haven't figured this out. Get help. Maybe it's going on right now in media, right? Which is a free resource to all of you. Go online to our, I think it's on the bottom of our page. There's a subscription thing. It's free. It's like the Netflix of Christian Bible study. There's all sorts of free resources. So maybe you and your spouse watch a video series together and grow closer, right? Or maybe you just need to watch one and start working on you, right? Work on yourself. Grow. Learn to be more like Christ. Maybe you need to read a book, go to a conference. Maybe you need to see a counselor individually or together. Maybe you need a mentor couple. There's so many couples in this church who would love to speak life into you and help you in any way they can. And the final one, we stay committed. We stay committed. Would you stand with me this morning? I don't know what you need in your life. I believe that the Spirit of God is speaking to you and where you're at. Would you receive that encouragement today? And can I pray with you? Maybe this is that moment where you need to dedicate your life to Jesus and say, Jesus, I need you to lead this life of mine because I can't do it on my own. Or maybe it's in your marriage. You just need to recommit to your marriage. If you're standing with your spouse today, would you just take their hand gently? And would you just, in the spirit of the moment, would you close your eyes? If you're not married, and maybe you're thinking one day you will be, would you just begin to pray for that person, right? Begin to pray for that person even before God brings them, right? Would you just begin to pray for your spouse? Ask God to give you wisdom, grace, discernment. If you need to surrender parts of your life, your pride, your sin to God, now's the moment. Just begin to tell God that. Father, in the name of Jesus, would you bless each marriage as we surrender to you, as we submit ourselves one to another, as we submit ourselves to you, that you would do the work that we can't do. But Lord, find us to be intentional. Find us to be persevering, to build a marriage that glorifies you and brings the name of Jesus fame in every space, in every place we go. Lord, grant it to those today who are struggling in their marriage, grace and peace, forgiveness. Would you grant them wisdom beyond their own experience and education, Lord? For those who desire to get married, Father, begin to plant the seeds of life, of life-giving marriage in them today for the glory of Jesus alone. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.